Hi everyone, thank you for joining us today for our webinar on alternatives to GDP, measuring well-being for a sustainable future. I'm just going to do a quick introduction of our organization, Engineers for a Sustainable World, and then I'm going to hand it over to Jenny Dodson, who will be introducing our speaker for today. So a few quick notes about using the program. Many of you that were in the class are familiar with the program. You know that you can either type in the chat box if you have a question or concern, or you can actually type a question and that will raise your hand and we'll be able to see your question. Ida's both going to have some questions for you as we go and leave some open time for discussion at the end. So thank you again for joining us today. As I mentioned, this is a joint collaboration between our organization, Engineers for Sustainable World, and the network of early career sustainable scientists and engineers. Engineers for a Sustainable World, our main goal is to forge lasting, innovative solutions to local and global sustainability challenges. We do this through student-based projects. We do this through educational seminars, short courses, including webinars like this one. And we do this by building a global network of engineers within our different communities and scientists. You can see on the map here where we're located. We have about 50 student chapters spread throughout the United States. And if you're not already an ESW member, check out our website at eswusa.org where you can become a member and see what else we have to offer. And with that, I'll hand it over to you, Jenny.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jenny Dodson, Executive Director of the Network of Early Career Sustainable Scientists and Engineers. I hope you can all hear me okay. Please write in the chat box if you have any problems listening to anybody during this webinar. So the Network of Early Career Sustainable Scientists or Engineers, or NESSE for short, as it's quite a long name, is a interdisciplinary community of early career professionals and researchers who are using science and engineering to tackle global challenges to achieve a prosperous and sustainable future for all. And what we're really trying to do is to inspire and mobilize a generation of sustainable science leaders. And we're really excited to work with Engineers for a Sustainable World on this webinar and other activities because of our shared interests. And what is NESSE doing? So NESSE is trying to do this in many different ways by sharing inspiration through researchers and professionals who are already developing sustainable science technologies and activities. We're building community online, sharing discussions about global challenges. We're building local communities. We're building local communities, local groups and institutions, and in countries. We're running training and events such as this one, both online and offline in person. We're partnering with lots of global international organizations and local organizations in order to achieve our aims. And we're also trying to bring together people around different global challenges. So I'm really excited that we are running this webinar with Engineers for a Sustainable World. And this has been part of a course that was run by Erin and Andrew at Engineers for a Sustainable World on ecological economics over the past 5 weeks. So we ran it last year and this year. And this is a topic that really is relevant to anybody working in sustainability in any discipline, because economic growth and GDP seem to be the driving force of all of our countries and societies, a key measure of success. When there's a major event or different political decisions, the biggest question seems to be, what's the impact going to be on economic growth and GDP? And also when we're developing new technologies and new ideas, often the first question seems to be, is this going to be profitable within our current system focused on economic growth and GDP? It's even a goal in the recent Sustainable Development Goals. But a question that's really, since I've been involved in sustainability and sustainable science, that's really troubled me is, can we have continued economic growth, you know, continuously for the rest of the future on a finite planet, and especially with the need to rapidly tackle the challenges of climate change and resource use, you know, are those compatible? So the question is, are there alternatives to GDP? What would those be? Can we have a kind of prosperous future that is focused on kind of human well-being and a good life for everybody on the planet that isn't focused around GDP? but I'm not an economist, and it's quite difficult to have the answers to the questions of a kind of paradigm around GDP that is present in the whole world. So I'm really excited that today we've got Ida Kubiszewski, who I met a couple of years ago at an early career workshop that was discussing the green economy. And Ida has done amazing work, you know, really, really groundbreaking work around ecological economics and thinking about alternatives to GDP and other measures to GDP. She's an amazing researcher, extremely focused on how we can work towards a kind of sustainable future. She's now senior researcher in ecological economics at the Crawford School of Public Policy at the Australian National University. She's also the managing editor of Solutions, which is a great journal which is focused on trying to share innovative sustainable solutions that we can get to a sustainable future. And she's also, alongside all of this work, I don't know how she manages it, she has also been a negotiator for the Dominican Republic at the recent climate change negotiations in Paris and before that. So I'm really excited that Ida's going to be talking to us today about alternatives to GDP and alternative measures to measure well-being for a sustainable future.
Thank you, Jenny and Aaron, and welcome everybody. So as Jenny said, I'll be talking about sort of alternatives to GDP and measuring well-being for creating a sustainable future, basically. So next slide, please. Hello. Okay. So I don't know how many of you have heard of the Anthropocene. So it's basically a new geological epoch that we're now entering in. So as you can see from this image is that there are not a lot of places in the world that humans have not taken over. Next slide, please. Okay, so as you see, it's not just humans, but it's also all our built capital. So it's stuff that we make and we distribute around the world. These are some of our communication routes, so shipping roads, etc. And as you can see, there's basically almost nowhere in the world, some places in Greenland, northern Canada, northern Australia, some places in the Amazon that are still not inhabited or inhabited but have less infrastructure, but those are growing fewer and fewer. Next slide, please. And all this kind of taking over the world is also bringing us to these tipping points within the Earth system. So it's affecting our environment. As you can see here, there's a lot of areas in the world that if something happens to one of those areas, there's sort of a cascade and impacts that we don't know about. So whether it's, you know, the El Nino changing or the coral reef being destroyed or Greenland ice sheets melting, those have impacts and consequences on a big part of the world. Next slide, please. And so we already see a lot of these impacts. So here you can see the average annual precipitation over the globe. And you see the brown where it's things are drying out and blue where there's more water. So scientists are predicting that as we go further into climate change, for example, the places that are drier will become much drier and the places that are wetter will become much wetter. So in this instance, if you look at the map on the right-hand side, between 1951 and 2010, the average, you find that sort of the Mediterranean has dried out. Go back one. So you see that the Mediterranean has dried up, and then that China is drying up, as is Australia. And the problem is that a lot of those are necessary to feed a good part of the world. So now imagine if parts of Africa that are feeding Africa dry out, a lot of people, especially the poor, will suffer because those that have the least will be impacted the most. And I'll talk about that a little bit. Okay, next slide. And we see that it's not only climate change. So I don't know who's heard of the planetary boundaries, but this basically shows that there are certain areas in which we have already exceeded. So if you look at the inner circle, you have the safe operating space. And it's an area where we know things are work and everything will kind of proceed as planned. There's that zone of uncertainty. So between the two middle circles where climate change has already gone and the land system change has gone. And the problem with that area is that because it's the sort of zone of uncertainty, we don't actually know what will happen. And we don't know if there's a tipping point within an area, where the tipping point is. We have no idea. And then there's certain things that we already have exceeded. So extinction of species, we've crossed that tipping point, and we don't know whether there's a way to get back or there isn't. Same thing, biogeochemical flows. We just don't know enough about the system and to know whether it's possible to get back, what the impacts will be on our lives, etc. So next. And we're seeing all that in the social realm as well. And so we're seeing a lot more social problems as a lot of these environmental problems are actually clicking in. In this case, you know, you see a lot regarding children, but it's impacted all around the world, including inequality, social issues, etc. Next. Because all these things are connected. So I don't know if you guys heard about sort of the four capitals, but none of the four capitals can impact human well-being without each other. So in case of, let's say, natural capital, and I've been told that you guys have had lectures on ecosystem services, those ecosystem services don't directly influence sustainable well-being. They all have to interact in some way with the other four capitals, whether it's social, human, built. So if one of those capitals is decreased, it does impact all the other ones, and then it does impact our well-being. Next. It's also what Kate Rao was. Can you click one more time? It should just move to the next part of the slide. But so it's what Kate Raworth calls the sustainable donut, basically. And the fact is that as we're dealing with all these environmental issues, we also have to focus on staying within that societal donut where elements of well-being, quality of life are maintained for everybody on Earth, not just the environmental aspects. Next. And one of those big aspects is inequality. So there was a great study done at the Harvard Business School a few years ago where the scientists asked people what they think, Americans think the distribution within the country was. And they asked the young and the old, the Republicans, Democrats, they asked everybody across the board. And they, if you look at that middle bar, that's what most people said, this is what we think distribution are. If you look at that top bar, that is actually what the distribution of wealth is in the U.S. And when they asked them what they would want it to be, they said that they wanted to be what that bottom bar is, which looks more sort of like Scandinavia. And so people also don't realize how unequal the distribution is within our society. Next. So Richard Wilkins and Kate Pickett published this great book called The Spirit Level a few years ago, where they looked at basically income inequality and its impacts. And in this case, they've created an index of health and social problems, which included, and you have the list on the right, so I'm not going to read it all out to you. And they found that there's a pretty strong correlation between as inequality goes up, so do a lot of these health problems. And they did it for also for states in the US, they did it for various regions and areas, and they always find the same trend that as inequality goes up, there's a lot of health and social problems that come in. Next. Okay. What they didn't find is, so there's a lot of talk about, well, if you just give people more money, everything will be okay. And they didn't find that. So if you look at the same sort of index and all the health and social issues listed in the box on the right, you see that there's actually not a strong correlation with national income per person. So they found basically that as GDP grows, people don't actually necessarily become better off, or their well-being doesn't increase. Next. Okay, and this was done quite a few years ago now, 2008, where they actually took GDP and correlated it with mean life satisfaction. And they found that, of course, in the beginning, when people are still limited in, you know, whether they're getting food, whether they're getting shelter, just the very basic needs, getting them money to buy food and shelter, of course, help increases their well-being. So nobody is saying, you know, that countries of Africa don't need to grow their GDP. However, at a certain point, though, GDP becomes less important in improving well-being. You know, if you already have 5 cars, adding that 6th car will not necessarily make you any happier. And often there's a lot of newer study out is showing that it'll actually make you worse off in the long term. And they're showing that as inequality increases in these societies, both the rich and the poor are worse off overall. So if you look at this graph and you see that, let's say where Venezuela or Costa Rica or Brazil is, they're at the same level of life satisfaction as US and Norway. And yet US and Norway have a much greater GDP and consumption level than countries like Venezuela, Costa Rica, Brazil, Mexico, which have lower GDP and consumptions, and yet their life satisfaction is just as high. Next. So this study just came out actually about last week, and it showed basically this group looked at, it's called the World Happiness Report, and they looked at what contributes to happiness, basically. The big thing, what they did miss out in this is sort of the natural capital. They missed out the environmental aspects of what contributes to well-being, to happiness. But if you look, you find that GDP per capita explains very little of what contributes to that well-being. And so we find this same thing over and over. Next. And Jenny mentioned the SDGs. And so this is one way for basically the world has agreed, you know what, let's deal with a lot of these issues. And not just GDP. So you'll notice that if you look through the SDGs, that the word growth is in there a few times. They do usually try to sort of put sustainable growth in front of it, but the word growth is still. And a lot of times that just means growth in GDP. However, they also do address, for example, goal number 10 is reduced inequalities. So they do, and inequality is distributed throughout certain areas, and they do try to get at some of the more intricate aspects of it. Next. What the goals do miss, so they do a really good job sort of defining the individual goals that we want to go at. What they do seem to miss, and there is discussions now within the UN to actually incorporate this, is an overarching goal or putting it all together into some kind of one indicator. So people that don't like, and there's a lot of these people that don't like the one big indicator, that's okay, because each of the goals will have its own targets, which will have its own indicators. And so you can look at all of those individually. The problem is that with the amount of goals, I think at the end, the indicators, it's over 300 indicators. So it's kind of hard to wrap your mind around it. So what the UN is, we're working with the UN right now, is to try to put together into one indicator in some way, so that people that do want to look at what's the overall well-being of a country, that's possible in just one quick look. And this is what this graph tries to show, is that that is necessary, and sometimes just to be able to say, this country is doing really well, this country is not going so well. So next. The big problems with GDP is that GDP interprets everything as an every expense as a positive. Okay, so for example, what this means is that if you have, let's say, a disaster. So everybody remembers the Katrina oil, the oil spill in the Gulf, or Katrina hit, or the tsunamis. If you look at what happens to GDP afterwards, GDP goes up because there's more transactions that are needed within society, right? So you have rebuilding and all this stuff that needs to happen, which GDP goes up. But nobody can claim that those things are good for society, that those things are positive things for society. The other thing is that it leaves out a lot of components that do enhance welfare. So a mom staying home, for example, is not put into GDP, and yet that's beneficial for society because they're raising a good kid. Or if you have vegetable garden and you pick your food from the vegetable garden one night because it's healthier, you're enjoying it, etc., that's actually detracts from GDP because you didn't go out and buy that food in the store. It also doesn't account for distribution of income. So it doesn't incorporate inequality, which we have found is a massive impact on well-being. So GDP, the best way to explain, and this is kind of a crude way, but it kind of gets it across. Imagine if a business was using GDP to determine its final sort of well-being, whether it was doing well, right? But instead of taking its income and subtracting expenses and finding, oh yeah, look, we had some positive income actually, what they do is they take all their expenses and all their income and they add it up. And that's kind of what GDP is. It's all the transactions that happen within that business, or in our case, within a country. And so that's what GDP is. And there's no way to tell whether society is doing well just by that measure. Next. So even the inventor, Simon Kuznets, the creator of GDP, didn't think that GDP was a good way to measure well-being, and he warned about the quality versus quantity of growth. So next. We recently published this article in Nature that basically talked about some of these issues, but then a way forward. Next. And we found that there's really three major alternative kind of ways to measure well-being. So there's one is where it takes GDP and corrects it. So, excuse me, I talked about these issues with GDP. And so you can adjust them by taking out sort of the things that aren't positives that add to GDP, but then also adding things that are missed out. There's those indicators that try to measure well-being directly. So, for example, mostly through surveys, subjective well-being. And then the third is composite, where it takes various aspects of whether it's subjective well-being indicators, but then it could take crime or life expectancy or GDP, and kind of puts them together as an indicator. And next. Okay, and so here's an example. So these indicators, there's actually hundreds of them, if not more. These are some of them, and they're split up into three groups I just mentioned. So for example, the top group is the one that tries to adjust GDP. One that I'll talk more about is the genuine progress indicator. But then the second grouping is sort of the subjective well-being. And one of the most famous ones in there is the gross national happiness done by Bhutan, which is a survey. It's actually quite a long survey. It takes about 7 hours to take. And then there's that less group. So HDI, for example, is where it's a composite where it includes life expectancy, GDP, and a few other things. So these are just a short list of some of the indicators out there. As I said, there are hundreds out there. Next. So the genuine progress indicator is one of those indicators that tries to adjust GDP. So it starts with personal consumption expenditure, which is a major component of GDP, and then adjusts it. So it subtracts the cost of environmental degradation, biodiversity. It adds some positives that were left out, so household work, volunteer work, and it also adjusts for inequality. So it does have, it uses the Gini coefficient to adjust for inequality. Okay, with all these indicators, none of these are perfect. With all these indicators, none of them are perfect. So you'll never get a perfect indicator of well-being. What we're saying is it's a better measure than GDP. So next. So Joe Stiglitz, Nobel Prize winner, talks about this quite a bit. The fact that there is this need to find different ways to measure well-being, basically. And so he talks about the firm's revenue and how that GDP just can't work for us. Next. Okay, so here are the components of GPI. So as I mentioned, it starts with personal consumption expenditure and then income distribution. So it usually is Gini coefficient that it uses. And then it adds basically value of household work, volunteer work, highways and streets, household capital, and then it subtracts some of the minuses. So you'll notice that the things in red are social capital, things in green are natural capital, and blue are human capital, and in white are built capital. And so you could look at a lot of the natural capital is being subtracted because it's damage to the natural capital, and it's negatives like crime, which doesn't benefit society, but does increase GDP on an underemployment, et cetera. So next. So this is what we get when you actually put it all together. So GPI is in red and GDP is in blue. And you can see that around 1970, I would say 8-ish, GPI levels off while GDP keeps growing. And you'll see this pattern. I'll go through a few of these for various countries. But you'll see a similar pattern where GDP keeps going up and GPI levels off or even decreases. That difference we found is mostly due to the cost of inequality and the cost of environmental damage, where the damage being done to the environment, the value of that damage being done to the environment exceeds any gains in GDP. Next. So we did a study, and this is US again, we did a study in which we compared a bunch of indicators. So in all of these, all the indicators are being indexed to 100 in 1990. So you'll see that they all meet in 1990. And so if you look, the blue is GDP in this case, and then the red is GPI. So they track each other for quite a while, and then GDP keeps going up while GPI levels off. And you can see that other things like biocapacity per capita goes down. Ecological footprint kind of goes up and then goes nuts. NHDI goes up a little bit. So next. So this is Australia, and you see similar trend. So you see that GPI and GDP tracked, and GPI went down and leveled off and has only recently started going up again. GPI is also impacted quite a bit by different policies passed, and you'll see that in a few countries that I'll show you where GPI goes completely up and down, and a lot of it is due to decisions made on the ground that have major impacts. Next. China. So China tracks the same pattern. GDP skyrockets while GPI falls along till about 1995 or so and then levels off. And we predict that with most developing countries, because we only did this study for about 17 countries. We find that even if you do newer countries, developing countries, they still follow the same trajectory. What happens is that their leveling off shifts over to, in this case, it's 1995, so it shifts over to later. Next. Poland. Poland is a little bit crazy. A big thing with there is the Soviet Union falling apart in around 1990, which had a major impact on the society there. So next. Thailand, we see the same thing. What we don't have in Thailand is any data going out past about 2005. So GPIs, we were dependent on the GPIs calculated by other people. And in this case, we expect for Thailand to keep going up a little bit more and then leveling off. A lot of Thailand will also be dependent because they're not, over the last few years, they haven't been quite politically stable, and that will be seen in the GPI. Next. Vietnam as well, similar trajectory, kind of leveling off starting around 1996-97, going up and down, so a little bit waffling there, but similar trend. Next. So if you look at these are all the GDPs per capita for the seven countries we did. And you see that there's, in general, a nice upward trend to all of these. But if you look at GPI, you find that that's not quite the case, that a lot of them show leveling off, and then some actually dropping down, for example, like Belgium, which did drop off in the last few years quite significantly. Next. So we took all those 17 countries. So those 17 countries basically made up about 65% of the world's population and about the same amount. I think it was 68% of the world's GDP. So majority of both, and put them together and found that you see this on the global levels. GDP keeps going up. GPI levels off in 1978. One thing we did not do, because we could not find the data for, is there were no African countries in our study. That was not intentional in any way. We just did not have the data. We expect, though, if we do include African studies, we would see the same global trend. What would happen is that leveling off would happen a little bit later on. So next. And so this is what Herman Daly calls economic uneconomic growth. That on the right of the line, the uneconomic growth is you have growth, but you're actually worse off because of the inequality and environmental damages. So the value of what the planet holds is actually decreasing instead of increasing like GDP shows. Next. Then if you put that together with GDP versus GPI, you find that it levels off around, or even decreases a little bit, around $6,000 to $7,000 dollars per capita. So this is per capita, and we find that at about after that much, GDP doesn't impact well-being that greatly. Next. So there are some governments that are starting to use GPI as part of their official indicators. One of them is Maryland, which was the first one. Governor O'Malley basically announced that although they'll still be calculating GDP, they will also be using GPI. And the great thing about it was that a few years after they started using it, GDP actually decreased significantly in Maryland. But the governor was able to go and to talk to the people and say, look, you know, we have our environmental, our state is better, doing better environmentally. We have less unemployment. People are actually better off even though GDP went down. So it's okay because this GDP going down doesn't mean that we're doing badly. Next. Vermont has followed shortly behind. And they actually put into their constitution that they will now be calculating GPI as well. And there are about 10 other states that are considering it, including Oregon, Colorado, Hawaii, Utah, and a bunch others. So this trend is growing. Next. And this idea that there other things need to be considered and taken into account as getting into the federal level of the U.S. as well. In October of 2015, Obama released this memo to all the agencies, organizations, departments in the government saying that whatever they do from now on, they have to consider ecosystem services as an aspect of any decisions they make. So it's slowly, this idea is slowly growing. Next. And businesses are also getting in on this. So NAB, the National Australian Bank, is also working. I have a project with them that's looking at agriculture systems and looking at how well a farmer is managing their natural capital. And what the bank wants to do is, if the farmer is managing their natural capital really well, that means it reduces risk on both the farmer and the bank. And so the bank is willing to decrease their interest rates. If a farmer is totally overgrazing or putting too much pesticides in and completely destroying the water quality, their interest rate will be much higher because the risk is greater for both the bank and the farmer. If there is a drought, if there is a flood, if anything happens, the farmer will do a lot worse off. And the bank is starting to realize that, so they're adjusting their interest rate based on that. Next. And there's a company called True Cost, which actually does this for other businesses. So they're, what they do is they look at what the ecosystem service impacts are of various companies. They recently, I believe in 2014, did it for Puma, where they looked at, they were able to say, for everything you do, here's the amount of damage actually you do to the ecosystem that you don't calculate for. And here it is per shoe. So if you were to take the full cost accounting of every shoe, here's what it actually would cost. And this gives Puma then opportunity to go back and actually adjust, one, how they price things, but two, know where the damages are and try to limit them. Next. They also did this study globally for all companies in the world, and they found that companies were actually using $7.3 trillion in unpriced natural capital, which equates to about 13% of global economic input in 2009. So this is not a minor thing. So next. And this has been looked at quite a bit sort of on the government level. So Peter Victor, who is a traditional economist in, he has training in traditional economics, but he's more of an ecological economist now, in that he did this model where he wanted to see whether he could take the Canadian economy and do a traditional model that all economists use on the economy, but then adjust it so that he gets a flat GDP and want to see if there would be any kind of collapse. And he found that if he did nothing else but flatten out GDP, he would actually get a collapse of the system. However, if he adjusted other minor policies, he found that he could actually level off GDP and actually make the society better off in the long term. So if you hit next, and we'll be going quickly through the next few slides. So, the 12 things he found he had to adjust to make a stable economy was, the first one was, this is sort of like the 12-step program, but was new means of measures and success. So we talked about GPI, GDP, et cetera. Next. Limits on material, energy, and waste land use. Next. More meaningful prices, so full cost accounting. Next. More durable and repairable products, so we don't get a new iPhone every year. Next. Fewer status goods, so buy what you need, not just because your neighbor has it. Next. More informative advertising, reducing how much brainwashing the advertising companies can do. Next. better screening of technology, knowing what technologies are actually beneficial and which ones are not. Next. More efficient capital stock. Next. More local, less global. Next. Reducing inequality, which we talked a lot about. Next. Less work, more leisure. I don't think anybody would object to this. Next. Education for life, not just work. And so those are the big 12 that he found he had to adjust within the society and determine what policies he could pass to actually create a stable economy that didn't have a growing GDP. Next. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ida. That was fantastic. We've got time now for about, I think we've got about 15, 20 minutes for questions. So if you want to ask a question, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put you all off mute, but if you put in the chat box for the GoToWebinar kind of little aspect on your screen, if you put an exclamation mark in that, then I'll call on you to ask a question to Ida. So has anybody got a question? For the moment, I will ask. I've got quite a few questions. That was a really fantastic talk. So what that aspect at the end was really interesting, because that's one of the things that's always concerned me, and I guess other people out there, is can you have a kind of stable system that doesn't have loads of crashes and doesn't cause lots of hardship to people if you don't have this continuous rise in GDP. I was particularly interested in the kind of aspect that was looking at new technologies, knowing whether technologies are good or not, which you just touched on. I mean, do you know any more about that, because that's something that's always really interested me, is how can we know whether the technologies we're developing are going to be beneficial or not before they get out there? And at the moment we seem to take a kind of the approach that we the kind of technology runs ahead, and then kind of society is suddenly like, oh, actually maybe that wasn't a good idea. So do you know any more about that? Were there other suggestions?
Okay, yeah, no, I was clicking and it was just not going. Okay, so I don't know too much more about it. I know that Peter, what he did was he basically looked, there's always going to be uncertainties. We can't predict the future. We don't know. What we can do is try to determine whether any of these technologies that we do implement will have consequences in different areas. So all these things are connected. The social, the built, et cetera, the four capitals that I mentioned, they're all connected. And so often when we develop these technologies, we don't try to look at what the impacts are on the other aspects of society, of nature, et cetera. And so having sort of a more informed way of doing that and assessing that technology. However, you can never predict completely, what a technology, what impacts they'll have. What you can do is try to do a full cost accounting and sort of a full cost analysis on that.
Okay, great. Okay, we've got a few questions now. So Chiok said, sorry if I'm pronouncing your name incorrectly, most examples seem to come from advanced economies. Are there similar examples from the developing world?
Wait, say that again, sorry.
Most of the examples, I guess,
GPI
come from advanced economies. Are there similar examples for the developing world? And I guess added to that, is there examples of how developing countries can kind of get onto the right trajectory, get on a kind of trajectory that's getting the right economic growth, but then stabilizing out?
Yeah. So the reason that most of the examples were from the developed world was not by intention. It was because the GPI has been done for many of those, and it's just the data that was available. Since that study, so that study came out in 2013, I've gotten about 10 more countries. Some of them are from developing countries more and more. As the idea of GPI spreads, more and more countries are actually doing calculating GPI for their nations. So that is starting to happen. There is actually none for Africa yet. There is one being worked on for South Africa. Again, South Africa, I know, is the most developed country in Africa, but in some ways that's to be expected because that's where people have the resources to actually do that kind of calculation. I predict that within the next 10 years, we will have GPI for a majority of the countries out there. But we are finding as these developing countries are coming out, unfortunately, they still have the same trend. To the second question, yeah, so basically, you know, if a country that's developing, basically they have to get out of this whole race to the bottom in some ways, where all we care about is GDP. We don't care about, you know, our environment. We can, you know, look at China, what they did. Their goal was GDP and nothing else mattered. And but yet today, you know, you go there and you can't drink the water, you can barely breathe the air, etc. So the idea of let's just develop first and then deal with the environment, that's been proven not to work quite that well. So I hope that answers your question.
And I suppose, like, linked to that, then, are there, you know, are there challenges with getting the statistics for this? Because I guess GDP, one of the benefits of it is that it's just a single statistic. I don't know. I don't really know how easy it is to,
No, but that's the thing, right? So you look at, if you do any kind of these kind of studies where you need to use GDP, you'll find three or four different sources would have very different GDPs, and they're all right. The problem is that GDP has 100 indicators to it. Each country that calculates GDP has hundreds of people working all year round to calculate GDP. It's a really complex indicator. It's not easy in any way to calculate. And yet we do it for GDP, but then the argument is, oh, we don't have the resources to do it for anything else, which is a little bit weird, though, because I know, like, there's a whole department in the U.S. and Australia, it's not thousands of people, and their entire job is to calculate GDP.
Fantastic. So yes, hopefully there'll be a move in that direction. So Cristiano also asked, so there's lots of hundreds of possible different indexes that you might choose the right one.
You know, so there is, so it depends on what you need in some ways. There is no right or wrong answer often, in that they all measure slightly something different. We use GPI because we found that it's sort of encompasses all the major issues. And then when you do put it against subjective well-being, which is in some ways the only direct way to measure well-being, it actually tracks pretty closely. And so that's why we started using GPI quite a bit. However, well, that's one of the big problems why GDP hasn't been replaced. It's not that GDP is easy to measure or that all these other indicators are, you know, harder to measure. It's actually the reverse. The reason is that there's no around a single indicator. So we have, you know, we've had these kind of meetings and workshops with Nobel Prize winners, presidents, et cetera, over the last few years. And although everybody agrees that GDP is not the right measure, nobody can agree on what the right measure is. And so we don't use a different measure. And that's the problem.
Do you think there's some movement in the right direction, in the direction towards having a...
There is, well, the first step was to acknowledge that GDP wasn't the best measure of well-being. So that's sort of the first hurdle. The second hurdle is what is the right measure, or what is a better measure? I think the UN moving in this direction with the SDGs and trying to say, okay, what is sort of a holistic indicator will also help this a lot as well once they implement. So the indicators for the individual goals are supposed to be released in sometime the first half of 2016. And then after that, a lot of us are going to be working on how to put that all together. So,
watch this space. Yeah. And do you think then that it might actually replace GDP? I mean, do you think there's enough of a movement? Because it looked like, you know, you were showing, say, Vermont and some other states where they're, I mean, they're still used. You know, it's such a well-known example. Do you think it would just take time for a different one?
Yeah, honestly, I don't think GDP is going to come soon. I think what's going to happen is that we'll bring in another indicator to kind of run alongside GDP. GPI has done in Maryland and Vermont and these other states. And so I don't think GDP is going to go away. It's too entrenched system and in our sort of mentalities to go away anytime. So we would need a major paradigm shift, which are not easy to do. So, yeah, I don't think that's going away anytime soon.
Does anybody else have any other questions they want to write in the question box? I'm just going to ask one more question whilst anybody else writes a question. Have you seen in some of these countries or places that have introduced these measures that it's actually changed the policies that have been implemented? Because I guess that's the real question. Does it contribute to a change, and are they more, you know, are they more sustainable as well? Are they more environmentally sustainable?
So the only two places GPI has been officially adopted has been Maryland and Vermont. And we have seen that the policies are a little bit different. The most interesting one I saw was with Bhutan. So in Bhutan, they have the Gross National Happiness Index, which is a survey. But what they do, which is even more interesting, is that they almost have a policy filter. I guess that's the best term to use. It's a GNH policy filter that before they pass any policy, their definition of happiness has these like 8 or 9 pillars. And what they do is before they kind of run the policy through the impact would be on these 8 pillars. So it's what I talked about with technology. You have to look at the broader impact. And so a great example, I was a few years ago, and we were working with the Prime Minister on some of these issues, and they had a vote in their cabinet, and we had the pleasure of actually sitting in, and they had a vote, and they voted whether to join the WTO. And so they have a vote before they run, after they run it through the filter. And so beforehand, every minister voted to join the WTO. They're like, you know, this will be great for our country. It'll, you know, bring money in, et cetera, et cetera. And then they ran it through this filter. A few days later, they had the same vote. Mostly voted not to join the WTO because that filter showed that it would have massive impacts on the social and the cultural aspects of Bhutan, on the environmental aspects of Bhutan, which they valued more than just increasing GDP. So in that case, it was a, you know, very clear policy determination.
Wow, that's really incredible. So that's World Trade Organization, if anybody.
Sorry about that.
Okay. Do you think the shift beyond GDP will be driven by governments only, or can the private sector help drive this shift?
I think it has to be a bottom-up and a top-down movement. Honestly, I don't think the governments will voluntarily do any of this. I think it has to be a push from both the bottom, and that includes the public and the businesses. And I do think there's a lot of movement in governments in this direction, but it's sort of more individuals within departments. So a lot of departments have, or the welfare departments are looking at different things, but they're not being in sort of integrated into the bigger indicators. I think that it's sort of like, I always like to look at all this stuff as a bucket with water. You know, all these things are a drop in the bucket, and all at some point there will be that tipping point where that last drop, and might be the smallest, stupidest thing that just, you know, knocks the bucket over and all the water spills out, and we'll have our paradigm shift. And so all these little things, both from bottom up and top down, matter quite a bit in filling that bucket.
I think that's a great point to stop, really inspiring point. So where I think all of our actions working towards a sustainable future will hopefully help to fill that bucket towards a paradigm shift towards a sustainable future. And I hope, and I think that we are moving in the right direction. So just to finish off, just to say, do you get involved with Engineers for Sustainable World and with NESI? There are lots of ways to get involved. If you go onto our websites, volunteering, writing for the blogs, running local groups. We're both organisations are very keen to support younger and early career scientists and engineers to get involved in working towards a sustainable future. And also NESI will be running another webinar on the 12th of April, which will be around sustainable science careers and industry. We've got three great speakers who will be sharing their career paths that they've taken and how they've managed to embed sustainability into their careers. So I hope you will join us for that, and I hope you've enjoyed this webinar. Thank you very much to Ida and to all of you for joining us. Have a great, if you're celebrating Easter, I hope you have a great holiday, and the rest of you, yeah, have a good week ahead. Bye.
Thanks, guys.